There were the photographs that shocked the world. A terrified man nose to nose with a snarling dog, a human pyramid of naked men, and a hooded figure standing on a tiny box, his outstretched hands attached to sinister wires. The Abu Ghraib photos are now some of the most famous images ever created. Taken by ordinary soldiers, they show how prisoners in Iraq's notorious Abu Ghraib prison were treated by the American military. When they were published in the New Yorker magazine, they created an international outcry. But how to interpret these strange pornographic artifacts of war? Is seeing really believing? Academy Award-winning documentary maker Errol Morris set out to investigate what happened outside the frame of the Abu Ghraib photos. His resulting film is called Standard Operating Procedure, and he joins me now from Boston to talk about it. Errol Morris, welcome to Late Line.
Thank you very much for having me on.
We think we know what these pictures are, and we think we know the kind of people who would take these pictures, but in the making of this film and in interviewing most of the protagonists involved in this whole affair, what did you learn about the people?
I learned that they weren't monsters, as they had been portrayed in the press. They were people very much like you and me. I, of course, was very interested, why did they take these pictures in the first place? I don't think there's one simple answer, but what is really clear from talking to them is they were also disturbed about what was going on around them, and in many instances took these pictures to document the abuses.
Yes, there was one particular case where one woman you spoke to was horrified by what she was seeing, and she chose to take the photographs in order to document that so that when she got out, she could show the world these photos. But when you say they're people like you and me, I can't imagine standing by and taking those photos and being involved in doing the thumbs up when seeing those events. Can you imagine doing that yourself?
Well, it's a question, of course, that I've asked myself again and again and again. What would I do if I was put in this kind of position? One thing is crucial to understanding these photographs. This was policy. The treatment of these prisoners came not from these low-down soldiers, but from much, much higher up in the chain of command. So the question is, what happens when you're a soldier and you're asked to do something which, remember, we're in a war zone, which is immoral?
So they decide.
What do you do?
They decide to do it even though they have qualms about it. But I wonder if in researching this project, you uncovered that there's following orders, which is the age-old defense, and then there's some other kind of culture that is organically created in the depths of despair of a place like Abu Ghraib. Some other kind of dehumanized culture develops. Is that what you found?
I think it's a combination of both. One shocking element of this story is the sudden realization that much of what we see in these photographs is quote-unquote standard operating procedure. That this was the way they expected these prisoners to be treated. I find that perhaps as appalling as the photographs themselves.
No one higher than a sergeant was even tried for any crimes resulting from this once the photographs were made published, yet virtually everyone you spoke to was in some way found guilty and punished. These are the absent figures in your documentary, aren't they? The ghosts, the higher-ups who are in charge of the policy and who, at least in one case, were responsible for torturing one person to death.
I've been asked repeatedly, haven't we learned since Nuremberg that just following orders is no defense? I remind people that at Nuremberg we put on trial the highest officials of the Third Reich. We didn't put on trial privates, corporals, sergeants. The people that have been responsible for these policies have never been held to account for what they have done. And to me, that is a grave injustice.
So do you complete this documentary seeing these rather young, in many cases, and somewhat ignorant Americans. Do you leave this documentary thinking they are responsible for their actions or that they're not?
We're all responsible for our actions, those soldiers included. But I hope people watching this film start to think about what it would have been like to be there. We're talking about a nightmare created, yes, by the soldiers who were there, but also by the policies that put them there. And if people start to think about this in a different way, then I believe I've told an important story.
There are some cultural commentators who, upon seeing these photographs, said that this represents exactly what's gone wrong with American society, or some elements of American society, a youth culture that's been degraded, if you like, by exposure to too much violence, to too much pornography and the like. Do you agree with such commentators? One of them, I think, at the time was Susan Sontag.
I believe that every culture is capable of doing really, really, really bad things. Americans like to think of themselves as better than all of this, and the sad realization, and the photographs played an essential role in this, an end of our dream about ourselves, that somehow we were the good country, we were the good guys. This puts that all in question.
Do you want us to empathize in some way with the soldiers that you interview for this documentary?
Absolutely. I want us to see them as people, not as monsters. Much, much too easy simply to dismiss them as beyond the pale. Much harder to really look at them as part of the human community.
After Abu Ghraib, in your view, what, if anything, has changed in the United States about the way the US government and the military goes about drawing up its procedures and then implementing those procedures for interrogation in the theater of war?
I'm sad to say very little. The policies that made Abu Ghraib possible are still being followed. I think that's perhaps the most discouraging aspect of this story. This is not unusually American, but it's certainly part of how humans conduct themselves. We have this amazing capacity for denial. We would like to think that it does not say anything about ourselves or about our culture. In that respect, I respectfully disagree. We're just wrong.
The difficult thing in all of this, of course, though, is that in the theater of war, and I guess we just have to be a bit brutal here, the usual rules don't apply, I guess. You've used this dreadful phrase, standard operating procedure, and that's how many of these incidents were dismissed. But when it comes to the theater of war, those procedures that we might find repellent in ordinary civilian life sometimes are simply something that has to be accepted as in some cases, a matter of life or death. Is that how we also have to look at this incident at Abu Ghraib?
We should remember that there have been international conventions to deal with the excesses of war, the Geneva Conventions being one perfect example. I would hear again and again and again, whatever we were doing at Abu Ghraib, we were following the Geneva Conventions. Now, of course, this is untrue. We were, in effect, operating a concentration camp in the middle of the Sunni Triangle. The photographs are misleading in this one important respect. We think we're seeing everything. I remember when I first saw these photographs, I thought Abu Ghraib was a couple of tiers, a couple of cell blocks, a few dozen soldiers. Abu Ghraib, by the end of 2003, was the intelligence hub of the American war effort in Iraq. There were some 10,000 prisoners there, and everything was a violation of Geneva.
And it went on for so long before it was discovered. As a documentary filmmaker, as someone who makes his living relying on the meaningfulness of image making and of images, and as someone who's come to doubt, I guess, the reality and truth of photographs, what has making this documentary done to your project as a documentary filmmaker? Has it shaken your doubt, shaken your faith?
Well, 20 years ago, I made a film, The Thin Blue Line, that got an innocent man out of prison. I'm a great believer in pursuing truth. You can pursue truth with a pen, and you can also pursue truth with a camera. People can be misled by photographs, they can be misled by words. The important thing is to try to look beyond words and photographs at what really happened.
Errol Morris, thanks for joining us on Lateline.
Thank you for having me on.